Well, we're here at Cairns Marine. There's eye candy everywhere, and I see a species that aquarists struggle with and have lots of questions about. Let's look at these guys.
Yeah.
Wow, so, look at all these.
I know, check them out. These are our Elegance Corals. You guys would know them as catalophilia as well, or cats.
Right.
So very famous, absolutely beautiful, beautiful species, large polyp, stony coral.
And I've always heard the Aussie ones do best.
Well, these look like they're doing pretty well. I can't help but say, but brag about them. They're pretty healthy and gorgeous, and yeah, ours do very, very well, yes.
So a lot of aquarists struggle with this species. Why do you think that is?
Oh gosh, there could be a whole host of reasons. It's really difficult to always know why the end user, you know, our hobbyists would struggle with a species like this. I can't help but think that it could originate from collection or handling and shipping. They're notoriously dirty when they first come in.
Dirty.
So, yeah, dirty. Parasites. They'll have yucky things growing on them and crawling on them. And they're actually living in very deep water. Well, not overly deep, but deep enough water in very silty bottoms, yucky clarity.
Okay.
You can't see in front of yourself to see what you're collecting. When our divers are collecting them, they're picking up out of that silty, very high flow, but silty substrate.
Okay.
And with substrate often comes bugs and bacteria and whatever else. So when we first bring ours in, we actually acclimate them from the wild environment into our facility. So before they ever come into this tank and get organized, all of our animals, including the catalophilia, will go through an acclimation period. And then once they've been acclimated, they also go through a prophylactic bath. So depending on the species of coral, they'll be dipped in something that gets those flatworms and other creepy crawlies off of them to clean them up. And we have to inspect them regularly. They've got lots of folds and little bits and areas and pieces where things can hunker down and hide.
Okay.
So we have to make sure we didn't miss something. So it's not uncommon for us to have to dip them more than once. And then, importantly, we rest ours here. These animals are sitting nice and fluffy. A lot of them have are open well enough that they want to feed. So lighting, flow, water quality, all the things you would expect an animal to need to thrive, we provide to the cats.
But we gotta get a good animal. It's gotta be cared for, and then when I get it in my tank, they're in murky water, so they don't need a lot of light.
True. You can see the light's quite blue here. They don't like really intense light, but we like to keep them under light that's appropriate for their habitat. So knowing that they don't come from the top of the reef, exposed to bright sunlight all the time is key. So we like to educate our clientele to make sure they understand the collection location, habitat type. And, you know, we know that there's a ripping current going through where they're found. Even though they're in a silty bottom, lots of flow.
Yeah, these guys are getting more flow than I would expect to put them into my tank.
Right, right.
They're
so any of those things could be contributing to people not succeeding with them. I might have mentioned to you that I'm a big believer in acclimation.
Yeah.
Well, when you get an animal from a shipment or even an LFS, you can't just take that animal from the water it was in and dump it into new, different water, expecting it to thrive.
Okay.
So any step along the process of handling, you are a part of the supply chain. The end user is the end of the supply chain. So they need to be a critical part, play a critical role in the success of the animals.
Dirty water, clean water, feed them, don't feed them.
Well, dirty water and clean water are something that can be quite subjective. The clarity of the water is not good, but the water quality is great.
Okay.
So, yes, they love high nutrients. This whole system that we're standing in front of is a nutrient-loving system, nutrient-rich. So we allow there to be a little bit of nitrate. We don't mind. We feed them a lot. Very high flow as well, and then the lighting is adjusted to the appropriate level for this species.
You said a little bit of nitrates, 5 parts per million, 20 parts per million?
Yeah, no, it'd be low, but not acro low. You know, if your systems are too stripped of nutrient because you're making acro thrive and you don't allow those acro to have any nutrient in their water, a lot of species like cat may not love it because they do love food, they do like nutrient in their water, and it actually doesn't hurt them. It's a good thing.
So where do I feed these guys?
They will actually eat big pieces of food. They'll take brine and lysis and things like that. But we actually blend up a really just kind of a mixture, a formula of a wide variety of things, because you never know what they're going to be picking up in the wild. So we just like to give them a mixture, and then they'll catch what they want and let the rest flow through.
Okay.
So, and then feeding a little bit a few times a day is always better than a lot at one time. You don't want any food settling in their flesh or resting underneath them, because then you create a host of other problems with nasty things like protozoans growing.
All right. Well, I'm going to pick some up for my clients. Thanks for the tips.
Yeah, my pleasure. They're gorgeous, aren't they?
Absolutely.
Yeah, I love them.